A couple weeks have passed since I received the Chronos high-speed camera. I don't have any amazing footage to share with you. Instead, this video is a collection of tidbits I've learned about the camera. I hope you find something helpful or at least interesting. I ordered a grayscale Chronos high-speed camera and initially received a cutter camera, and that gave me a chance to compare the two. I selected the grayscale camera originally because of its better ability to gather light and its slightly higher resolution. With the same settings, lens, and lighting, the grayscale image does look brighter. This can be verified by summing the intensity across all the pixels for each frame. The dip at the beginning of the graph is the light's dimming as the saw speeds up. The color camera is dimmer and has slightly less resolution because of how a color camera sensor is made. A color sensor is actually a grayscale sensor with a color filter array attached. This is called a bare filter, and it assigns half of the pixels to be responsible for detecting green light, a quarter of the pixels for red light, and a quarter of the pixels for blue light. Green light is emphasized because our eyes are most sensitive to green light. By restricting the wavelengths of light to each sensor cell, the overall brightness is reduced. This is also described in the spectral response graph, which shows the efficiency of converting photons to electrons. Since each pixel only receives a portion of light or one color, interpolation from the neighboring pixels is done to create the final color or RGB value. The interpolation has the effect of reducing the resolving power of the color sensor, even though the resolution of the final image is the same as a grayscale sensor. The next observation concerns the amount of compression that YouTube does to uploaded videos. A 1 gig video file uploaded to YouTube and then downloaded using YouTube's own interface becomes 26 megabytes. I doubt if you're going to see a difference viewing this video on YouTube, but areas of smooth gradation become blocks of the same intensity. To emphasize the effects of the YouTube compression, I computed the difference between the videos. The videos are aligned, and for each aligned frame, a new frame is created. The new frame contains a difference in pixel value offset by half the maximum pixel value. In addition to emphasizing the loss of information in the YouTube compression, the difference in the grayscale video shows an interesting banding pattern. The bands move inward as the lights dim and outward as the lights brighten. The bands are also pulsating regularly. In a previous video with the Chronos camera, we saw a halogen light pulsate as it warmed. If a light could cool down fast enough, it'd go out twice per cycle at AC mains as voltage crossed zero. The cycle of the AC current might explain some of what we see in the difference image. Also, the grayscale video has additional structure which is lost in the noise of the color video. You may not see the pulsing of the light in the video, but in this graph, I've zoomed in on a section of the previous intensity graph, and you can see a fluctuation of about 1-2%. Performing Fourier analysis on this data reveals that the strongest frequency component is at 120 Hz, exactly as expected with 60 Hz main crossing zero twice per cycle. The best DC lamps that I have are a couple of IKEA LED desk lamps that I use for a microscope. The IKEA lights are dimmer, consuming 1/200th the power of the 1000-watt halogen, but the light is more directed. For testing light stability in this example, they'll work fine. The previous dip in light intensity is gone because the LED lights are consuming so little power that they're not competing with the saw. YouTube's mutilating video compression helps to emphasize the difference between the AC and DC lamps. The video compression converts smooth gradients into uniform regions of gray. The bands show the boundaries between those regions. The bands in the AC video are pulsating because the intensity is constantly changing. The bands in the DC video are stationary because the light is constant. Some lights emphasize the flicker more than others. This is a Cree SBR30 LED lamp. For comparison, this is a halogen lamp. Some LED lamps I can see flicker with my eyes, but this Cree lamp I need the high-speed camera to see the flicker. Now we'll look at frame rate and file save times. A comment I received on the last video was, even at 3000 frames a second, the saw blade is still moving fast. And someone else commented that it's possible to nearly get 39,000 frames per second, and that should be greater than what's necessary to capture 1 degree of rotation at 3600 RPM. This sounds great, and other than the loss of resolution, the drawback of this high resolution is a save time. Instead of 2.5 minutes, which is typical to dump the entire 16 gig buffer at 3000 frames per second, 30 minutes was necessary to dump a fraction of the buffer at 39,000 frames per second. The save speed is identical between a Class 10 SD card and an eSATA connected SSD. Save time must be bottlenecked by video compression, and hopefully when raw frames can be saved, that save time will decrease. The focus aid didn't work well for me at the higher frame rates, but this may be because of insufficient lighting. Finally, if you're seeing horizontal banding, be sure to redo black calibration. It's clearly marked in the manual, but I had overlooked needing to do this for every record setting. Now let's take a look at lenses. All three of these lenses are Japanese lenses. In the last video, I was using a Goyu lens, and that lens is a small one amongst these three. This lens is from Goyu's 10 megapixel line and is for small sensors with high resolution. The Goyu lens is overkill for the Chronos camera, but its lightweight doesn't tip the camera over. The medium-sized lens is a computer zoom lens that Kron Tech sells with the Chronos. This lens is heavy, but its versatility and price makes it a bargain. The massive white lens is a Canon 100 to 400mm zoom lens from their EF line. Adapters are available to convert Canon's EF to C-mount. EFS lenses also worked with the adapter without an iris. With the iris, the EFS lenses lacked about 5mm from seating. Similar adapters are available for other camera manufacturers, and they're great because they let you use lenses that you may already have. Here we have a Canon lens at 400mm on the Chronos. The picture quality is better than what I expected, but the screen is impossible to see in full sunlight. There doesn't seem to be a way to adjust contrast or brightness. I was sitting in a park shelter and I still couldn't see the screen. The strong vignetting is because I had the iris closed nearly to a pinpoint and didn't realize it. Once the iris is opened a little, the vignetting disappears. The Chronos high-speed camera has been a lot of fun and has strong potential as an inspection tool. But it's going to take time to learn best practices, and I'll share with you as I learn. Please let me know if you have any suggestions. Thank you for watching, and we'll talk again soon.